In biology, one of the primary principles is referred to as the central dogma. The fundamental simplicity of what the central dogma means is that, according to Francis Crick, information in biology only flows in one direction, from the DNA to the RNA and to the protein, which is us. The relevance about this is then our lives are controlled by our DNA. Now I want to say a very important fact, because I was teaching the central dogma in medical school to medical doctors. What was I teaching them? Just think about it. That genes control a person's life, and a person's life does not affect their genes, and therefore people become victims of their heredity, whatever they inherited that was in their family line. First thing, what is a gene? Well, a gene is a blueprint that is made out of DNA. I say blueprint, but for what? Well, the blueprint is used to create the proteins of the body. And the proteins of the body are the molecules that give us our physical structure and our behavior. And in fact, it's interesting, the term protein means pro, primary, teen, part. So even way back when they identified protein, they knew right away this is the primary part of a biological system, protein. Proteins are very complex molecules, but proteins also break down very quickly. They're what we say labile, not stable. Labile means they break down. I go, so why is this relevant? Well, these are very complex molecules that create this whole physical structure, and they break down, we have to replace them. And then the big question came, well, what's responsible for creating the proteins? Well, that was a big intellectual pursuit until 1953. And in 1953, we were provided the insight into the DNA double helix offered by Watson and Crick. Even though, as we've talked about earlier, the real double helix story came from a woman, Rosalind Franklin, and Watson and Crick essentially borrowed her research without her knowing it, and came to the conclusions of how DNA is a double helix and the basis of a gene code. DNA is a blueprint. And ultimately, this blueprint is going to be used to create protein. But then I have to say, well, it's not a direct blueprint that we use. I say the original blueprints are in the nucleus of the cell. These are the original pieces of information. It's sort of like the Declaration of Independence. We don't use that. We put that away, and it's hidden in a vault, and nobody messes with it, but we make copies of it. Same thing with DNA. It's very precious. You don't want to mess with it. But what happens is a protein system will make a copy of that DNA blueprint. And that copy of the DNA blueprint is called messenger RNA. And the messenger RNA, the copy, is actually used to create the proteins of the body. So as proteins break down, then what we do is engage a gene to make that protein, engage it by making a copy of that gene called messenger RNA. The messenger RNA goes out into the cell, and then that is used as a template to create the missing protein. So there's a sequence of information, and the flow of information, now we understand it is, proteins are the building blocks, RNA are the actual molecules used to make the proteins, but RNA is a copy of the DNA. So we have an understanding of the flow of information that came from Watson and Crick. And it is this, that information in biology only flows in one direction. It starts with the DNA, goes to the messenger RNA, which is a copy of the DNA, and then that is used as a template to make the protein. You, as the proteins that are derived from this central dogma, cannot go back and alter the original genes. This is the belief that led us to understand that we are victims of our heredity. Whatever genes you have, they control your life, and you do not control the genes. This is the story of the central dogma, a unilateral flow, DNA, RNA, protein. Very interestingly, as a professor in a medical school, I was teaching medical students the concept of the central dogma. It was only after I left the medical school that I actually looked up the meaning of the word dogma. And the significance blew my mind, because dogma means a belief based on religious persuasion and not scientific fact. And all of a sudden I started to realize I have been teaching religion in medical school when I have been teaching what is called the central dogma. Well, how did Francis Crick come up with the word dogma? And the answer is, when it was actually confronted with the truth of what dogma meant, he acknowledged, I didn't really understand the word, and I used it, but a much better word would have been hypothesis, which is more accurate. So instead of the central dogma, what we're really referring to is the central hypothesis that information goes DNA, RNA, and protein. Well, a hypothesis, by definition, is not a scientific fact, it's a suggestion. In 1958, when Francis Crick offered the central dogma to the scientific community, they just thought this was the greatest of revelations, something like Moses coming with the Ten Commandments of how biology works. The fact that we go DNA, RNA, and protein, they were looking for an answer like that. And when it came out, they said, ah, it sounds great. They accepted it. But what was the point? The point was, it was never scientifically assessed. It was a hypothesis from day one, but it was repeated in textbooks from 59, 69, 79, 89, 99, still in the textbooks, that the central dogma is an accurate scientific understanding of the flow of information in biology. No, it's not. It was a hypothesis and never proven to be true, just repeated so frequently that people accepted it as truth. Everything changed in 1969 when Howard Temin, working at the University of Wisconsin, working on the HIV virus, found something totally unique and actually was chastised for his findings. What did he find? He found that the HIV virus is an RNA virus. But what's unique about it? There was also an enzyme attached to that virus called reverse transcriptase. And what was that? Well, Howard Temin found out that this enzyme took the RNA molecule and reverse programmed it back into the DNA so that the HIV starts out as an RNA but ultimately becomes a gene in the cells that are infected with this virus, reversing the flow of information. Well, you have to have seen what happened to Howard Temin when he was trying to present this to the public, because all the central dogma people jumped on him and said, no, information only flows in one direction. But between Temin's research and others, such as David Baltimore, another famous virologist, they all came to the same conclusion. Reverse transcriptase is an enzyme that will take messenger RNA and alter the DNA going back against the unilateral flow. And all of a sudden it says, well, first thing, oh my goodness, the central dogma is wrong. RNA can actually go back into DNA. In his HIV study, the reverse transcriptase enzyme is actually built into the virus. That would suggest that, oh no, regular messenger RNA cannot go back into the DNA without this very special enzyme, reverse transcriptase. But guess what? Once the human genome was completed, it was recognized that 10% of our DNA is actually coming from viruses and virus-associated proteins. It is now recognized, built into our own DNA, we already have reverse transcriptase. Well, the predominant use of that reverse transcriptase deals with something called telomeres, extensions of the DNA. That's not the only reverse transcriptase in our nucleus of our cells. The other reverse transcriptase can do exactly what the same enzyme did with the HIV virus. We have built into our genes reverse transcriptase molecules that can take messenger RNA and put it back into the DNA. And so all of a sudden, it really says that reverse transcriptase is not just isolated in viruses. We each have our own reverse transcriptase molecules in all of our cells because it's part of our genome. It was such an important finding that Harold Temin got a Nobel Prize for identifying reverse transcriptase, an enzyme that will take RNA and put it back into the DNA as a gene. Well, that was the start. But by 1990, a bigger explosion in central dogma occurred, and that is the insight that led to a new science called epigenetics. Epigenetics is the science how environment alters the readout of the gene. I go, how can it do that? Because the nature of the system is nothing goes back and alters the gene. Well, Temin's reverse transcriptase challenged that for sure. But what did they find out? That the chromosome, the hereditary units in our cells, are actually 50% DNA and 50% protein. I go, so what? I say, well, in studying the DNA story, scientists routinely separated the protein from the DNA of the chromosome, threw away the protein, and just worked on pure DNA. What did they get from this story? Well, they found out Yes, the DNA programs a protein, which they always thought, but the big question was then, what's programming the DNA? And they did this experiment, and I said, what was it? They took a DNA double helix, they separated one of the helices, so now it's a single helix, and they take that single helix, put it into a beaker with the building blocks of DNA, and incubate it. But when they pulled out what was once a single DNA molecule, guess what? When they pulled it out, it was actually turned back into a DNA double helix. The DNA coded for its own complement. In other words, DNA codes for DNA. And all of a sudden, the answer came very clear. DNA makes proteins, DNA makes itself, central dogma. DNA is in charge. Well, problem. What about the 50% of the proteins they threw out? What were they doing? 50% of the chromosome is proteins. They said, that's not relevant. We just want to study the DNA. So I said, why is this a problem? First thing is this, there's no place in a biological cell where there's something called free DNA double helix. Every time you see DNA in a cell, it's always complex with proteins. So the idea I can study DNA by itself and remove the proteins is an artifact. Why? There's no place in biology where DNA exists by itself. And so the study that showed that DNA can reproduce itself, artifact, totally wrong. Why? It's not natural biology. So I said, what did we find out in 1990? And this is actually, I was doing the pioneering research onto this in 1967, but it took until 1990 to recognize epigenetics. And I said, what is it? It's how the environment alters the proteins on the chromosome, but the proteins control the activity of the DNA. While the original story of the central dogma concluded with what we refer to as the primacy of DNA in controlling your life, meaning your life is an expression of your DNA and you have no power to control that. That was the hypothesis. Well, that hypothesis is now incorrect because now when we put all the information together, how the information flows through the system, it doesn't start with DNA, RNA, and protein. It starts even higher than that. It starts with environmental signal affecting chromosomal proteins, which in turn affects the DNA readout, which affects the RNA readout, which ultimately affects the body in itself. So the whole idea is not the primacy of DNA anymore. If you look at the flow of information, the top level of that flow is the primacy of the environment. And this basically says how you respond to the world in which you live. The environment you're responding to is actually controlling your genetic activity. And I say, and the relevance about that is, well, central dogma made you a victim of your heredity. You can't control the DNA. That's false. We now recognize that the environment, and more specifically, our perception of that environment, actually is what leads off the control of the DNA reading to get you to the protein. And all of a sudden, we go from victim, primacy of DNA, to master, primacy of the environment, because I can change that environment, I can change my perception of the environment, and in doing so, I change the readout of my genes. I'm not a victim. I'm a master of my heredity. But the most important fact is this. We must recognize that those that are still touting the power of the central dogma, this is a very false statement. The idea is, no, DNA is not the control of your life. As we talk about in the biology belief, consciousness, your perception, your interpretation of the world is what controls your genes. Since you can change that, that means then you can change the genetic readout, which then means you are not a victim of your DNA, you are the master of your DNA.